is what it is. There's your creatures.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, she asked for info and me. She better not sit in here. But we need to move back one because this is Beth's family.
So you?
Oh, okay. You're fine. What I'm thinking is we can't fill this, so we should move back. Don't worry.
There's some people out that way.
This is for family, and this is for family.
Oh,
and I'm sitting on the end.
Oh, okay.
But you can come out this way.
Oh, are you going to sing?
She's singing. Yes. So why don't, can you just move back one?
Yeah, we'll move back.
Okay.
Thank you.
You can stand right here if you want.
Welcome, friends, family, church, community. My name is Kama Hamilton Morton, and I'm the senior pastor here at Grace United Methodist Church. And it is an honor to be with all of you on this day as we honor the life of Betty Johnson. I invite you all to take a breath. Whew, there's been a lot of activity already this morning. So as we gather in the Spirit of God's presence, may we look around and see those we know, maybe find someone new that you don't know well or haven't seen in a while, as we lift up the life of Betty today. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Betty Johnson. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant all of us grace, that in pain we may find comfort, that in sorrow we may find hope, and that in death we may find resurrection. I invite you to join me in an attitude of prayer. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, you may hold us up in the light. Speak to us once more, your message of life and of death, and help us to live, O God, as those who are prepared to die, that when our days here are accomplished, we may go forth to live, so that, living or dying, our lives will be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus. We lift our silent prayers and thoughts to you this day. Amen. At this time, I invite Daughter Chris forward.
My heart's overwhelmed to see you all be here today, but I thank you for coming to honor Mom. You all probably know, I'm Chris, her daughter. This is Gary, my wonderful husband. I'm honored to be sharing her eulogy with you today. During her last years in the assisted living, I spent many hours with Mom recording her special memories. So I refer to them during this eulogy. Betty Jane Ashworth was born on December 10, 1927, in Wilkinsville, Tennessee, to Abner and Mary Christine Ashworth. Yes, I was named after my grandmother. And named after Aunt, she was named after Aunt Betty, the family's wash lady. She grew up in rural Tennessee, where she graduated from Munford High School in 1945. She was active in cotton farming and was proud of the fact that she picked 200 pounds of cotton in one day. In her younger years, her one shining moment and most meaningful award she received was the 7th grade beauty contest when her mama made her a taffeta dress. While working at Memphis Naval Air Station as a young adult, she met Clarence Burt Woodman from Denver, Colorado. They married in 1949 and moved to Denver shortly thereafter. 10 months later, I was born. Then Jeffrey, 3 years later, and then John, 5 years after Jeffrey. Mom loved being a homemaker and mother, and later an active grandmother to Timothy, Kellyanne, Kelly, Alexander, and Josimar. After 28 years of marriage, my parents divorced. During her single years, Mom worked at Ken Denver Country Day School, where she was a receptionist and welcoming face to all who entered. She was highly admired and enjoyed by the staff, students, and parents. We saw during that time that Mom's personality really came alive. My brother John expressed it so well in a letter he wrote to her. You give all the colors that life mercifully and marvelously have to offer to us. The reds, the blues, the purples, the pinks, the yellow, the greens, and all the shades of life that the infinite number of admixtures make. This is your gift, Mom. During this time, she met Roger Johnson, the love of her life, and they married in 1986. What attracted Mom to Roger was that he was such a gentleman, and what kept her love alive was that Roger was the most thoughtful, kind, and giving person she had ever known. Mom then became a stepmother to Roger's three adult children, Martin, Nikki, and Paul Jr., all of whom added to the joy of the marriage with their loving support. Additional grandchildren were added to the family and became their joy together. Liliana, Annie, Mitchell, Zach, Jessica, and Nick. And then 13 great-grandchildren and 3 great-great-grandchildren. Mom and Roger enjoy season tickets to the theater and symphony and making the yearly visit to Georgetown. They were both active volunteers at church, along with Roger being a docent for the Denver Zoo and guide at Roxborough Park. They moved from Heather Gardens after living there for 30 years to Brookdale Assisted Living 3.5 years ago. Unfortunately, age took its toll. Roger died 2 years ago, but Mom continued on wanting to reach 100. And by the way, I have an aunt here with us today who is 100 years old, Auntie Dari. Praise God. But the Lord had other plans for her. Along with her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren, and nieces and nephews, Mom leaves her 2 surviving devoted sisters, Sarah Fleming from Fort Collins, Colorado, and Nancy Meckling from McCune, Kansas. And this beautiful arrangement is from them. Marion Hicks, the oldest sister, passed away a few years ago. Mom asks that she be remembered as one who had a heart full of love and forgiveness. She received love and forgiveness from her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and extended it to others. As Mom's physical body was wasting away, her spiritual body was becoming more alive. And we saw 2 Corinthians 4:16-18 being fulfilled. Therefore, so do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but that is unseen is eternal. Mom's final days, we saw her focus on the eternal, proclaiming loudly around the clock, "He whispers his love to me," as loud as she can yell it. "He whispers his love to me." A song she perhaps played as the pianist at the Quito Methodist Church. "He whispers his love to me, he whispers his love to me, lest I should stray from him away, he whispers his love to me." Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John 14:6. He also told us, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. This is our hope. This is our joy. This is our peace. He's coming again. John 14:1-3. Mom is with Jesus now, experiencing his love for eternity. Thank you for coming today to honor my mother. I know she would be so very grateful.
Thank you, Chris and Gary. I believe there may be a person or two from the family or friends.
Yes, please.
Okay.
Could be rough. Hello, everyone. My name is Jeff Woodman, and I am Betty and Clarence's second child, the dreaded middle child. Yeah, I had a great life with my parents. My mother was special. And it's interesting how life goes, you know? I mean, there are lots of twists and turns, and lots of changes, and lots of ups and downs, and you know, what I'm learning is it's just about experience. It's just about experience. And I don't think it matters what it is personally. I'm standing before you here today, a child of God who's loved, and I'm grateful to see everyone here. My sister and I were talking a little bit about who would be here. I mean, it's a big mystery to me. And with our, like Dolores and Ed and Kathy, they've lived here in Denver for 100 years. And you know, honestly, I never thought I would see my cousins again. For some reason, I don't know why. I never thought I would see my aunt again. So I'm really grateful for this. And I just have to mention my son. My beautiful son Alex, who is 33, and he and Amma had an incredibly wonderful relationship. And he's really heartbroken that he can't be here today, but he has other commitments to his life, you know. He's a young working man. He's got to take care of his old man. We moved to Wilmington, North Carolina in September. And when that happened, and Betty and Roger, well, Roger had passed, but anyway, he said, I want to move. I said, okay, where do you want to go? Because I didn't really have anything in Fort Collins keeping me there. I sold my business, and Alex and I moved there, and we have a very blessed life, and a lot of that has to do with what my parents did for me and what Roger also did for Alex, who also had a very special relationship with Roger. So I'm really grateful to be here today. And Mom was a lot of fun. She was, yeah, I could always depend on my mother to be there for me. And for that, I'm grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
Oh, God. I'm sorry, guys. I have to say something.
Please do.
And, I know we all miss my beautiful brother, John. Mm-hmm.
Debbie's granddaughter is. She always called me Kellyanne. She's the only one. Well, that side of the family calls me Kellyanne. Mm. And today my heart is just so grateful. Grandma sought out relationship with her grandchildren, and I wish everybody had a grandma like I had. A time that was so special to me was the college years. Right before I went off to school, my grandma took me on an overnighter to go check out the campus in Greeley. And it was so special. I remember that night in the hotel room, for the first time, she really opened her heart to me and told me about her past, told me her story, her thoughts. Oh. And at that point, she continued being my grandmother, but she also became such a special friend. And that was the beginning of a correspondence that lasted all through my college years. And I could count on every week there would be a letter from my grandma. Mm-hmm. And she would tell me about her volunteering and who she'd seen and what she was doing and about her garden and ask about all of my friends by name. Mm-hmm. And then once a month she would drive to Greeley and take me out to lunch. And we would spend the afternoon catching up and talking. And, you know, Grandma, she didn't ever act like she had all the answers. But she was very quick to listen. She had a heart that was so supportive. She was a cheerleader. She was so affirming. And I just so appreciate the way her life spoke to me. She's a woman of such great love and humbleness and forgiveness. I'm so grateful for her life.
Hello, I'm Tim, Betty's big man. She always called me, Tim, you're so big. Like, Grandma, I do want to take that. So, but, you know, you have so many memories of Grandma. But one that, where she showed up for me, this is going to sound weird, but it was at my first child's birth. And it was odd because there were two little ones that I had adopted. So the doctor thought that this was my first, or not my first rodeo. Then I knew exactly what was going to happen. And it was my first, and I lost it, completely lost it. I was terrified that something was going to go wrong. And Grandma stepped in and just took me by the hand, said, Tim, let's go eat. And so she took me downstairs to the lobby of the hospital and just began to talk. And like Kelly said, she wouldn't come at me with answers. She would come at me with love and humility. And you talk about the calming effect she had on me, which she always did, love talking. But that moment was very special to me because she helped me gain composure so I could go back in and enjoy my little Corey's birth. What a gift. And then I would say Grandma showed up at the end. When you're all alone and you have no one else and no one else can understand your suffering or anything that's going on. To me, Grandma showed us what it was like to leave. And I'll never forget that. And once again, it's because we all know that who she really adored was Jesus. That's who she really adored. And that made all the difference. So I'll always remember my grandma in such a wonderful way. And she will be missed. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Tim. Howdy. My name's Kirby Hotchkin. I'm also the middle child. I'm here to represent the High Country Hillbillies that lived across the street from the Whitmans. Now, Jeff and I, as a middle child, have this understanding. I used to tell people that my first name was Kirby, like the vacuum cleaner, and my last name was Hotchkin, like the disease. So you're a diseased vacuum cleaner. You're pretty close to my name. It was Jeff who had my back and said, you might want to change that because I'll start calling you an anemic Eureka. Now you heard about a whole bunch of grandkids and great-grandkids and kids, and you're going, this woman had a full plate on Sunday. Well, let me put this in perspective of where we are. So you should know at this point, she had three kids that she paid for. She had a fourth kid that she was leasing, and that was my sister. Now, we called her Mickey, they called her Michelle. They were a little more kind than we were. My sister Mickey can't be here today, and she asked me to read a letter that she sent with some sibling instructions. So I want you to know this is already toned down from where I was going to take it. And just because this is coming through me, please understand, it's not the same as if she was here and it was coming from her. I had the privilege of knowing Betty since 1958. She was the mother of my dearest friend, Chris. Chris and I were in Bluebirds together, a part of the campfire organization, but lived in different parts of the city. To my great delight, Betty and her family moved across the street from us in 1961. Chris and I had become close friends, and we became even closer. Betty, known to me in those days as Mrs. Woodman, always made me feel welcome. She called Chris and I her twins. She had many friends in the neighborhood and always had a warm, beautiful smile for everyone. She hosted bridge parties in her home and loved to visit with everyone. During the 60s, the times they were a-changing, like the Bob Dylan song, one memory occurred in 1964. Chris and I wanted to ride the bus to downtown Inglewood. That was the place to go shopping at that time. We dressed alike with cut-off jean shorts that were frayed and long pink t-shirts. There's a pair of Twinkies for you. Betty, of course, was not pleased with our trendy look. Now, and I can't hear her saying it. Now, girls, it is not proper to go downtown looking like that. We pleaded with her, but finally, she let us go. I know she was secretly hoping we wouldn't run into anyone we knew, or more importantly, anyone she knew. After countless birthday parties, slumber parties, and family outings, Chris and I moved into our high school years. Betty was always there to talk to us and offer gently advice. Sometimes we listened, sometimes we did not. As the years passed, Chris got married and I moved out of the neighborhood. I still tried to visit with Betty on my visits to my family across the street. Betty and I had many conversations across her kitchen table. Instead of being Mrs. Woodman, Chris's mom, she became a dear friend. When I became engaged, I brought my future husband, Bill, to the kitchen table. She was always happy to see us. As the years passed, we always stayed in contact, even when Bill and I moved to Washington State. We always received a lovely Christmas letter each year from her. Many times, she would start the letter in October and add pages as it got closer to December. Many times, hers was the first card we received. We so looked forward to those letters. Chris and I have remained the best of friends. Chris will always be my best friend. Mm-hmm. Betty and my mother both both played a big role in encouraging and allowing our friendship to grow. It is one of the greatest blessings in my life. Betty, thank you for all the wonderful years you were a part of my life. You will continue to be when I reflect on my fondest memories of you. I love you. Now I would like to add quickly a little sibling supplement. It's one thing to read scripture. It's another thing to memorize scripture. But it is an extraordinary thing to become scripture to somebody else. And in my life, before I experienced 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26, I had the example of that in Betty Wood. And here's that quick story to help you remember. You know how kids get together at Christmas time, and especially before Christmas time, you're talking about what you want. You know, the Mattel, Mega, Mumbo, Moron Maker, whatever. You want some real big, heavy hit toy. Well, we always went over to each other's houses on Christmas. And of course, before Christmas, we were going through all the stuff we wanted. And Betty asked me what I wanted for Christmas. I was 8 years old when I did this. And I said, well, I'm a little scared to tell you because it's not going to sound very fancy. She says, well, what is it you want? I said, want me a shirt with a collar so I can wear my bow tie when I go to church. Because back then, you weren't cool, fool, unless you were hip at church with a bow tie. All right? I mean, all the men wore nothing. And don't, I'm not slamming none of y'all. Please. But you always wore church. You know, we went to church, and we went to the same church. So I wanted a knife. I wanted a shirt with a collar. Now, I didn't know that all these ex-World War II military guys, they starched their collars, okay? I didn't know that's how they made that look cool. Well, Christmas came, and I got my shirt. So we go over to the women's house, and I got my, you know, whatever, Mattel, Moron Maker, whatever it was. But I'm in my shirt. Now, all of us kids are, you know, oh, you got this, and that's a good hip and cool string, and you're gonna, you know, and we're all digging on that. But Betty came up to me and said, you got your shirt. And I said, yeah, I did. And she says, and it looks awfully good. She never pointed out to me, you know, the cardboard collar stay thing? That, I had that in there. That's why this woman, when I think of this verse, she actually was happy for you when you were happy. That's a long ways from being selfish. And that's why she was really sad, if you were sad. So if we are happy today, please be comforted. I'm sure that she's happy for us. In the name of our great God and King Jesus Christ, may these words be acceptable in His sight. Thank you.
Thank you, Kirby.
Thanks, Jeff. Sorry to pick on him.
Thank you.
So, my name is Nuriyuni Aki, and I work in Brookdale's, where Miss Betty lived for 3.5 years. So, I know Miss Betty and Roger Johnson. So, as Roger passed away, I was beside him. But with Miss Betty, I was in my vacation in Nebraska to see my son, and I got texts that Miss Betty passed away. But just remembering how is she, that she's a wonderful person, She's loving person. When I, so what I do at Brookdale, administer medication. So I always see Miss Betty twice a day for 4 or 5 days a week. So I'm really close with her. I feel like she's like my mom to me. And it's happy to see her when she talk to Jeff and Chris, especially in the pandemic, that no one can visit their loving in the facility. So Jeff always asked me if I can, he can talk with mom. So I was 2 weeks, yeah. So this is the first time I meet Jeff, usually on the phone. So I just want to say that very condolences and so sorry about Miss Betty, but we know she's happy to meet Roger in heaven right now. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. And of course, there are so many more stories that I hope will be shared personally, through calls, through cards, and as the days and weeks and months go by, to feel free to pick up that phone or to have coffee and share our memories of Betty. It is an illustration of how one life ripples out to so many. Thank you. I'm going to invite everyone. The scripture focus, which the family suggested, is the one that people pray all over the world, the 23rd Psalm. And it is printed in your, is it printed in your bulletin?
Yes.
Okay. Did I print it in there? Yes, so I invite you, if you wish to just listen, that's totally fine too. But if you wish to pray it along, you know, the Psalms are the prayer book of the Bible. And many people, Jesus would have had these memorized. Many people have taken Psalms or parts of some of the longer Psalms to help with their devotional life. And this is one that around the world people have honed in on with imagery for their prayer life. So this is from the King James Version. I invite you to pray with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Liz.
Beautiful.
Dear ones, Chris and Jeff, to all of your extended family, to friends, to church and community, we gather here today, and I hope that you may feel the power of the grace and peace of God with you. I encourage you to be with one another, to support one another, and to share with one another, as we had a glimpse of a few moments ago, your experiences with Betty, because often it can be in the sharing and the hearing and the telling, the laughter and the tears, that our healing can begin. We gather this day to pay our respects, to share our memories, and to proclaim our faith as we celebrate the life of Betty Jane Ashworth Johnson, a beloved daughter of God. Now, Chris, did I hear that these flowers behind me are in the colors from, was it from her wedding?
Roger.
Okay, so the beautiful carnations, the pink and the baby's breath, had a special connection. As so many of you have shared, Betty's life and witness touched many people along the way and in different ways. The family wanted to share that 23rd Psalm, which is that classic prayer of devotion that millions of persons from the Jewish and Christian faith have memorized and used through the generations. That Psalm is just one biblical reminder for us that whatever unfolds on our path, of life, of living, of relationship, personal struggle, emotional or physical hardship, tragedies or difficulties, as well as joys and blessings, God will be with us, holding us in the palm of God's hand, there for us to lean on, to learn from, to share the heights of our excitement and joy, the depths of pain and disappointment, anger or grief, helping us to get through each day. Betty knew the power of this promise held in that psalm, her own journey of family and love included times, the ups and downs of life, the ins and outs of brokenness and finding new love and life and healing with Roger and family. And with that came a growth of many kids, grandkids. I mean, the family grows and multiplies, both of blood and of neighborhood and of circumstance. And we give thanks for her ability to connect to so many. Betty was beloved by generations of family and friends, and as Chris's eulogy reflected the layers of life and of love, of experience and learning, of fullness and connectedness rippled out far beyond her one life to so many of you here, as well as those elsewhere. that one little pebble impacts beyond herself in so many ways, and we give thanks. Betty was a beloved member and volunteer here at Grace, and so many folks give their thanks for her ministry in our midst here. An unknown person penned this reflection, and as I read it, I invite you to think about Betty and also about your own life in these words. We trust that beyond absence, there is a presence, that beyond the pain, there can be healing, that beyond the brokenness, there can be wholeness, that beyond the anger, there may be peace, that beyond the hurting, there may be forgiveness, that beyond the silence, there may be the word, that beyond the word, there may be understanding, and that through understanding, there is love. And as Betty loved her Lord, the Lord of her life, so she became a presence of life and love for so many. As we move through this summer season, may we here and now open our hearts to receive both the grief and the gift of this day. May we pause to reflect on the memories and the lessons of Betty's life shared with us. And may we be reminded that as Betty was a light and an example of life and love for so many of us here, now it's our turn. Now we are called to leave this place to be that light for others, to be an example of Christ's love, of goodness, of truth, of understanding, of healing and humor, of thoughtfulness. God knows the world needs these things that Betty offered us a glimpse of. So now it's up to us to carry that light of Christ, which is love and grace, to a world that is yearning and needing evidence of love and light every day. As we leave this service, may we open ourselves to the power of God in our lives and in memory of Betty to go from this place to share God's presence with others. So as we breathe in, the Lord is our shepherd. May Betty now strengthen us and encourage us as a part of that blessed cloud of witnesses. May we take the words from the scriptures, the memories from our hearts to strengthen us, even as Betty has now moved from life to life. And for this, may we say, thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to join me in an attitude of prayer, to take a breath as we pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need, and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, give strength. To all who have sinned, grant mercy. And to all who sorrow, grant your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Betty to us, now we give her back to you. Receive Betty into the arms of your mercy. Raise her up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world, that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. I invite you, if you wish, to join me with the words of the prayer in your insert as we lift our voices in a prayer Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now it's time for us to sing, to lift our voices. We have one congregational song today, and it is Amazing Grace. And this is a beloved song in many traditions, not just our Methodist heritage. But we are going to do all six verses, so we're going to move along. But I did that. I was trying to think, should I take one out? And the words, I don't know, you know, many of us know the first verse, maybe by memory. But the words do speak to the stuff of our lives. And so I invite us to pray this and to lift our voices together. The words are printed in your insert. Let us pray and sing together Amazing Grace. We give you thanks for coming on this special day. Also, as an announcement, we are recording this service, and if there's, it will be edited and then uploaded to YouTube, and so I'll let Chris and the family know when it's ready, and if anybody wishes, our Facebook and our YouTube pages are Denver Grace UMC, and anyone will be able to find it from wherever they are, the blessings of the internet and all of that jazz. So as we breathe deep, we pray with and for Betty. Oh, good shepherd, receive Betty into your eternal fold with love and with tenderness. We offer you thanks for her life. Grant us now your peace as she joins that blessed cloud of witnesses that have gone before us. And now, sisters and brothers, may the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God. And the blessings of God Almighty, Creator and Christ and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. And all of God's children said,
Amen.
She requested Ann Clump and me to sing.